And it's good think at this point, John.
Yeah, had chances in a couple of them. Obviously the frame before on the last red, although he should have really removed it before off the second last red. But, you know, it's difficult for him out there. He's had a long 17 days. He's played really well. He's had tough matches all the way through. And he's just playing somebody who, quite frankly, is just a bit too good.
You actually both understand what it's like to be in this position in a final, because how much is the head swimming? Because we saw a couple of decisions that Graham had to make there, and his head really was all over the place.
The further you lose touch, the more you start to make a few wrong decisions and start to sort of double think yourself and lose confidence. And it's very hard to maintain focus sometimes.
Okay, well, two more frames is all that Ronnie O'Sullivan requires this evening. Of course, we'll be back live with that. But just before we go, one of the main talking points in sport is always about characters in sport. Are there as many as we all remember in the good old days? Now, in snooker, for example, is the new generation just as interesting as the last one? Well, making the case for and against is Ray Reardon and Dennis Taylor.
There's more better players in the game than there were in my day. Well, there's more players in the game. But the depth of and the quality and standard of play overall is much higher than it was in my day. I'd put it down to what? I don't know. Perhaps they only play snooker. Perhaps they don't have to work for a living now. There's more money in the game, so providing they can get into that financial situation. Yes, they can get better, but they are more dedicated. But characters, well, there aren't too many characters. I could be very unpopular in saying this, perhaps, but it wouldn't be a bad idea before anyone were to turn professional, and I probably in any sport, that they had to work for a year. Just to find out what it's all about, what people are all about, what the working class are all about, what money's all about. Put a true value, put true some perspective to it. In 67, John Spencer turned professional. Well, there was a funny chap. There was Graham Miles, who people thought he had another eyeball in his left ear. Cliff Wilson of Tredegar, you'd put him from anywhere. He only had one good eye. And then John Verger turned to the business of copying people with various styles, you know. Very funny. And then Dennis came along, who was very humorous and told stories round the table. Alex Higgins. So what a character, eh? He was the people's champion.
People say there's not as many characters around nowadays, but it was different back in the 70s. I mean, when I turned professional, you had to play exhibitions. That was the only way you could make a living. So you had to go around the country playing exhibitions. You were playing in the holiday camps, and you had to entertain the people. You had to tell a few gags during your trick shots. That's how it all started, and that's how people became characters. These lads that are playing nowadays, the game is played differently, but away from the table. I'm quite friendly with quite a few of them, Stephen Hendry, Mark Williams, people like that. Away from the game, they're terrific characters. When in this charming car, you can't expect someone like Stephen Hendry to turn round and crack a gag to the audience. It's just not going to happen. And Mark Williams, who is so laid back, has got a terrific sense of humour. Some of the fun that you can have with these boys is terrific. Jumped up country. All Ronnie O'Sullivan has to do is go and play a snooker. He is a real character, just in the way he pots balls.
Old or new, you decide. Well, we saw in that videotape Alex Hurricane Higgins, the legend, and we actually showed his return to action last night in the show. We've been inundated with requests to run it again, so here you go.
Terror. He couldn't have beat him. He was going in, taking sixpences of everybody. Play you for sixpence, play you for sixpence.
When my love said to me, meet me down by the gallows tree.
I was just like a knockabout kid in Belfast, and most kids at school used to stop into the billiard hall at lunchtime, you know, because school food wasn't that clever, so it was a Mars bar and a Coca-Cola and a game of snooker.
Some say troubles are bound. Someday soon they're gonna pull the old town down. One day we'll return here when the Belfast child sings again.
My game is good for a 54-year-old, you know, and he's had a few problems.
One and only, Alex Hurricane Higgins!
People say snooker's struggling. I'm coming here to play Alex Higgins at 1,400. To watch this match tonight. Preston sold out, the Pavilion sold out. So it's great, the snooker's on the up again.
Put your best foot forward and you're given a chance, you can probably still win. It takes a bit of determination. He's got lots of that. I've been a bit shy over the last 5 or 6 years, but I do like playing in front of a a nice crowd of people, and, well, a big crowd of people, and it's extra special to play Jimmy.
He still can play. He's got to find a bit of time to practice, but these little exhibitions and a few small tournaments and warm up, and who knows?
Mm-hmm.
Is that it?
Yeah. No. We're talking about
maybe bringing another doubles tournament back, and if we do, I will play with Alex.
Over here. Yeah. Either in Ireland or in a greater scale, but we'd like to make it up running again. It'd be good bit of fun for the other players as well.
If you're a snooker fan, you should definitely watch the play. It's phenomenal.
Well, I mean, they appeal to people that have all walks of life, and there's a lot in the play that you can see in the snooker, and you can say, oh yeah, he did do it a bit like that.
Let's get one thing straight. I'm what I am, and I don't give a damn whether you love me or hate me. I make no excuses. I live life the only way I know how. Fast.
No pause for breath, no time for reflection. A quick appraisal of the situation, and I'm in there. And I'm out again. I'm living on the hoof, heart to trot. A rolling stone gathers no moss. Can't sit still, never have.
Never will.
There's a lot to relate, whether it be Jimmy or I, in a play about myself or a play about Jimmy, and about the ups and downs of being a snooker player, right?
For those of you who think I'm washed up and washed out, well, I've got news for you. The hurricane hasn't blown itself out. You're in the eye of the storm.
One day we'll return here when the Belfast child sings again.
Alex on the way back, and it's great to see him wielding a cue again, playing well obviously as well, John.
Yeah, it looks like it, and of course one of the few players who can still put 1400 bums on seats.
Absolutely, yeah. Another one of course is Ronnie O'Sullivan, well on the way, you'd say, Steve, to his second world title here.
Yes, and deservedly so. I really do think he's matured immensely since the last time he won this tournament, and he certainly entertained the crowds here.
John, just a word about Graham Dott tonight, what can he hope to achieve?
Well, he'd like to make the score a little bit better, but we have to be realistic. I mean, the fella's absolutely fantastic, O'Sullivan. I don't really think he's got much hope in it, and I think it's just going to be a couple of frames for Ronnie and shake hands.
OK, well, we shall see, because we'll be back at 8 o'clock this evening. I'm not sure whether there will be a comeback from Graham Dott. He seems to be a little bit too far behind. But Ronnie's coronation should be worth watching. That's if it comes, of course. We'll see you in a few hours' time at 8 o'clock. Bye for now.
Cleaning. this morning from the strangest dream. I was in the biggest army the world has ever seen. We were marching as one on the road to the Holy Grail. Started out seeking fortune and glory. It's a short song, but it's a hell of a story when you spend your lifetime trying to get your hands on the Holy Grail.
Good evening, welcome to the Crucible. After 17 marathon days, it all comes down to this. A sprint for the line in the Embassy World Championship final. Ronnie O'Sullivan is already well ahead in the race, but 2004 will also be remembered as the year Dot, Graham Dot.
Winning inside the Crucible is the greatest prize in snooker by a distance. And tonight there'll be a very special atmosphere. There always is for the final session on the final night of the championship. When the players make their entrances very shortly, they'll get a rapturous applause from all this Crucible crowd. As we wait for their arrival, let's look back over this afternoon's frames.
Yes, the customary photos before each session of the final. And Graham Dott knows he would have to do exactly what he did yesterday to stay in this match.
But this is the type of shot that Ronnie is so good at. It's long red.
Out there, it must be cold. Both players now seem to be warming their fingers.
It's far from easy. But he's such a good potter.
Final night here at the Crucible is always extremely tense, especially for the players. And two former world champions, Steve and John, know exactly what they're going through.
You've been there before. You've done it before. You've proven you can handle the nerves, the pressure. But there's the expectation that you're supposed to win against a player who is supposed to be inferior to you.
You think, I'm nervous a little bit, but it's more with expectation of going out. I'm not really nervous about the result because nobody's really expecting me to win. It's the expectation knowing you're going out into the biggest match of your life.
And everybody's got their own way of dealing with that. Some people seem to be quite happy in the dressing room, others quite morose and quiet, others pace the floor.
I mean, you might pick up the cup of tea and you sip it, but you don't really taste it. And you keep looking at your watch and it never changes. These things are all horrible. We just want to get out there and play.
There's a small knock on the door a couple of minutes before. It's time for the big knock on the door.
The 18 frames will claim the trophy and a cheque for £250,000. Ronnie needs just two more frames. And in the commentary box this evening, we welcome the dynamic duo, Willie Thorne and John Virgo. Good evening to you.
Good evening, Hazel. The last session, the last day of the two... Oh, hello.
Good evening.
I can't say any more than that. We're snookered. There's always one. What's Graham got?
Thank you. Frame 25. Ronnie O'Sullivan to break.
Before we were very rudely interrupted, the last session, the last day of the 2004 Embassy World Championship, Ronnie O'Sullivan just needs two frames. This man needs something extra special. Has he got it left in him?
Certainly not a bad start. And in fairness, this afternoon's scoreline, when Ronnie won 7-1, this was the pot you saw just a few seconds earlier. It wasn't really a 7-1 scoreline as far as Ronnie dominating the session. Graham had a few chances and I think he was just a little burnt out this afternoon. I just hope that he can actually get off to a good start this evening.
Eight. Graham Dart, eight.
Well,
can you give the players a chance, please, gents?
Yes, referee calling for a bit of order. I think what happened just prior to the match starting got everybody a little bit excited. It's time to calm down. But that double Graham Dott just played, he didn't play as a shot for nothing. So I think it's going to be all-out attack. Terrific pot for Ronnie.
One.
Be playing in between yellow and brown and back in between yellow and brown for the red, I would think, just to the right of the blue. Just needs a little bit of check side to miss the yellow. Not quite enough.
Six. Seven. Yeah, sure. 12.
Packed house looking on. And unfortunately for Graham Dott supporters, so is he.
Thirteen. Twenty-one. Twenty-eight. 29.
As he has all week. First opportunity, red's in open play. That's of course what makes him the most dangerous player in the world at the moment.
36. 37. 44. 45. 52. 53. 53.
No need to play a kiss here. It appears that the top red of this four will pot in the opposite corner to the one he's playing the black. There's also a chance of two reds into the middle. 52 in front, red colour red, and he's one away 60. From being crowned Embassy World Champion for the second time in his career.
60. Yes, they might have not have many frames to watch tonight. And they'll be disappointed because they're watching a genius at work. I think
61.
Everybody agrees. probably the most natural, talented player that's ever played the game. And they might see a century now. He's played that delightfully. Just open those heads up.
66.
And
67.
Had applause because they know that the frame's now safe. 'There's a lot of things impressed us over the last 17 days, Willie, but we always used to
72.
Say, which head is he going to come with? Which Ronnie O'Sullivan is going to appear at the table.
73.
The Ronnie O'Sullivan that's appeared in this championship has shown respect for the game. And I think that's why he's getting his just rewards.
80. 81.
They're coming around two cushions here and trying to drop behind the two reds. If he kiss one, he won't be too worried. He'll be trying to drop behind them. Not hard enough. He's willing the cue ball, and it's still cuttable.
88.
Well, he'll be disappointed he didn't make a century for this capacity crowd. Graham Dott could only look on as Ronnie O'Sullivan goes one frame away from being crowned world champion 2004.
Well, it's certainly been eventful so far. I don't know the things our executive producer will do to boost the ratings. It's terrible, isn't it? But actually, there is our stats man, Phil Yates. It was immediately on to us with a pretty extraordinary fact, and that is that the last time Ronnie was involved in a streaking incident like that, or at least he witnessed one, was when he was 8-4 up in the final of the Masters against you, Steve, in 1997. He went on to lose it.
Yes, yes, call me old-fashioned, but it was boring then when it happened, and it's boring now. It's old hat. Once it's been done once, that's the end of the story.
OK. all this fuss about a little thing like that, John.
I know. When someone shouted in the audience, put a bit of bottom on it, Ronnie, that's not what he meant, I don't think.
OK, I think the coronation is just about to happen. But in terms of the way Ronnie's come out at the start of this first session, it could be, obviously, the last frame coming up here. We're just waiting for it to happen now.
He's played absolutely magnificently through the tournament. Andy Hicks must be very proud of the way he played. He got 13-11 with them early in the tournament because everybody else basically got blown away. 13-3, Anthony Hamilton. 17-4, who'd have believed that against Stephen Hendry, who's won here seven times, of course. And here he is from 5-0 down, just played magnificently well. And he thoroughly deserves to win the event. He's been the best player by a furlong.
OK, can Graham Dott put the brakes on? Let's get out there and rejoin them.
Well, I think Graham deserves to win a frame.
Quiet,
this
please.
Evening. OK, Ronnie
frame
looks like now sure
Graham
to be crowned
to
champion of the world. But I'd just love Graham to win one more frame because it'd just be terrible to go out tonight having played such a major part in this tournament. Not to just show this capacity crowd, just one more time, what a great player he is. Oh, there's the new remedy for snooker players next season, warm water. I just wonder, John, how many players in the clubs will be taking that to their table in the league matches on a Wednesday night in the hot water?
Yes, it certainly settled Ronnie's stomach when he had a little bit of a bug halfway through the tournament. Wonderful safety shot.
We're talking about things that impress you, John, during the championship, and I think that for me has been a major plus. Ronnie's obviously very meticulous in his break builder, but never been quite so meticulous in his safety play. This week, every single shot he's got 110%.
Absolutely, and you have to say, I mean, it came as a big surprise to everybody when Ray Reardon appeared in Ronnie's camp. But Ray Reardon was the master tactician, and you know, it could have just made the difference.
Yes, there was a spell in Ronnie's career where if he didn't make a 70 break in every frame he won, he wasn't satisfied. But this is one of the most difficult games in the world, and Ronnie's now realised through working with Ray Reardon for this last few days that, you know, you can get a lot of pleasure out of playing good safety.
Foul and a miss. Ronnie O'Sullivan, four.
Now, if one of these two reds will pot, the miss won't be taken. Well, he appears to be looking at some sort of... Well, he's looking at that red. It'll pot certainly off the right-hand jaw. It won't pot in the centre of the pocket. So there's not a lot of margin of error here. He's reluctant to have the balls replaced because he knows that Graham Dott can play a very, very good safety and put him in trouble. Can only see half the pocket. That's all he needed.
One.
Yes, this was an excellent shot. He's on the green. But it'd be difficult to pop the green and get the cue ball back to this end. Oh, maybe the brown goes. Brown was past the yellow. It doesn't look like it.
Yeah, sure.
And the brown gives him the perfect potting angle. There's Raimondo in the middle with the white shirt. And he's loved it here. And he's really enjoyed being involved with Ronnie. And I was chatting to him tonight, you know, Willie, and he said... They shouldn't call him Rocket Ronnie. They should call him Ronnie the Magician. He
Five.
Said he has never seen a talent like it on the practice table.
To be perfectly honest, there's probably not been
Six.
A talent like it on the practice table. Hendry, of course, has taken most of the accolades in the break building department over the years. And let's not forget, everybody's talked that Ronnie is unbeatable in this form, this, that,
13.
And the other. Hendry made 16 centuries in winning one of the championships of the world. Ronnie's only made 11.
14.
And Ronnie, would be hard to say, could hardly play better than this.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the only thing is about Ronnie, particularly a few times when he's got to the 80s
21.
In the championship this year, he started playing the rest of it left-handed.
22.
Just wonder, John, whether he'll play a cannon on either the reds on the right or the reds on the left to hold for that one at the bottom of the pack. Playing the full ball cannon off the one on the left, and that's perfect.
As
we say, just this frame. In the world championship for the second time. Ooh, and I was just going to say he'd love to
Ronnie
make
O'Sullivan,
a century
29.
Break. That was an unexpected miss.
Graham just said, "Don't you want me to have a go?" The way he played in the first five frames of this match, a match that, John, to be fair, nobody gave him a real chance. But the first five frames, he would have beaten anybody.
Yes, and his match against Matthew Stevens, he's really made a name for himself here. He always complained that he didn't get the credit he deserved. Well, they won't forget the name Dot now.
His family have been up over the last few days. His wife Elaine, mum Susan. There they are sitting, just hoping that Graham could make a little bit of a show of it this evening. And like I said a little earlier, I just hope he wins another frame. Of course, there'll be people who have bet on the outcome of the match, on the giving starts, the spread betting. I know my pal Racing Raymond, John, who you're well aware of, has had a few quid on Ronnie. He rang me this afternoon, said he's taken the rope off his neck. He was looking a bit dodgy when Ronnie was 5-0 behind.
just having a sip of his hot water as Graham comes round. I think we saw in the first frame when Graham played a very dangerous double, and I think it's the last throw of the dice time. I don't think he's going to refuse anything that he thinks he can pot.
Yes, it appears that he hasn't got a lot left. Ronnie O'Sullivan has choice of reds in the middle. If it goes in and gets on the black, a chance to be crowned champion again.
One.
For the red.
Eight.
Just above and to the right of the black. If he's got on that, that was a perfect positional shot. There you see it. His cue ball is just...
Nine.
...been magnificent throughout the tournament. Even when he was really under pressure, he's always had good control of that cue ball. It makes it so much easier.
16. 17.
Three reds, three colours. Graham Duttall need a snooker.
Yes, and you can't see him
24.
Making a mistake. I suppose the only thing that couldn't force him into an
25.
Error is the fact that inside, he'll be bubbling. He's worked very hard, been very disciplined, and he's going to get his just desserts.
32.
Yes, there's only won one tournament this year, let's not forget, and that was from 8-5 behind against Steve Davis.
33.
Yes, I think he's learnt a lot from those defeats this year, when he lost to Paul Hunter in the Masters. Oh, we see, he's thinking about collecting that trophy.
Ronnie O'Sullivan, 33.
That's what he was thinking about. He was thinking of what he was going to say at the winner's speech there.
1. And isn't it amazing? That just shows 1. You what the winning pose can do to you. Incredible.
Eight.
He has a perfect angle on this red to leave an angle on the black to play into pink and red, which would be the normal way round of going for the clearance at one visit. Leaves that red on the back cushion a little longer, but now he hasn't
9.
Got the angle to do that.
16. Graham Dott, 16.
That could be his last shot.
Okay, settle down, please.
Ronnie O'Sullivan just needs one red and a colour.
Can't for the life of me think why Ronnie's not playing the red over the pocket, just the red and black he needs. Okay, this should be a certainty, but we've just seen him miss a straight pink off the spot. In it goes, though.
1.
And that...
Six.
Quite simply,
7.
O'Sullivan has been the best player of the tournament. The smile up to his army of fans in the balcony. I'm sure the smile was probably to his mother who was sitting up there. to win the Embassy World Championship for the second time is something that most players
Come
have
on,
never
gents,
done
please.
Once.
15.
A big credit should go to Graham Dott. What a tournament he's had. He's got nothing to
22.
Be ashamed of. He's played, at the moment, the best player in the world. And the handshake, I'm sure, will come from Graham Dott. What a tournament. O'Sullivan has been quite simply magnificent. He takes the Embassy World Championship by 18 frames to 8 as the Crucible audience give him a standing ovation. Well played, O'Sullivan.
So there's a lovely moment with Ronnie's mum Maria. She only decided to come here to the Crucible a couple of hours ago. I think she was so nervous she was waiting elsewhere. Wonderful moments for Ronnie and his mum. You can see how much it means to the two of them. So Ronnie O'Sullivan becomes only the fourth player to win the Embassy World title twice here at the Crucible. So saluting his team. And now, as David Vine always used to say, it's payday. Ronnie will shortly be reacquainted with the famous old trophy he first lifted 3 years ago, because Ray is down there with the presentation party.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you'll agree we've had an awesome display of snooker from Ronnie O'Sullivan. Ronnie, congratulations to you. It takes two people to play in a final. Before we talk to you, Graham, what a performance you've given over the championship, and thank you very much. Ronnie, if I can borrow you for a moment, many congratulations.
Cheers,
can you describe the emotions you're experiencing at the moment?
If it would have been close, obviously it would have been obviously a lot more emotional. But you know, I had such a big lead coming into tonight that you know it's like a little bit of an anticlimax. But you know, Graham took me all the way, and you know he's so tough. You know, saying underdogs, this and that. But you know, at 5-0 down, I was sitting there thinking, you know, this is could be 18-0 to him. You know, but I was just pleased I got going. You know, and turned it around.
What about the snooker you've played throughout the championship and also the last couple of days? You've been incredibly composed, even when things haven't gone well, you just made them go well.
Yeah, well, I mean, my queuing hasn't been to, you know, the highest standard, you know, through the 17 days. I've queued well in spells, but, you know, plan B was, Ray's come down here and he's added a new dimension to my game. And, you know, I don't want to give no secrets away, but, you know, he's really improved me in certain areas, and, you know, I think that's where I need to develop as a player. And there's still room for improvement, so I'll just keep going and going, you know.
I'm sure you'll concede your opponent is tenacious and very gritty.
Oh, I mean, well, you know, people were saying, you know, it's going to be a one-sided final, and I'll tell you what, I knew it wasn't going to be, and, you know, it was no surprise. He's got qualities all over, and... you know, the players he's beat this week, you know, he's beat John Higgins, who's probably one of the greatest players that's ever played, Matthew Stevens, who always does well here, and you know, they're great players, you know, so what does that, that says a lot, you know, Graham's a great player as well, he's up there with the big boys, and, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if he's there.
Graham, when you smashed your cue up in January and sort of imagine 4 months later you'd be here playing in the World Championship final?
No, absolutely no chance. I couldn't beat anybody really the way I was playing.
What have you learned about yourself over this last championship and these last few days?
Well, the last few days I've obviously learned that Ronnie's phenomenally good. the first couple of sessions I managed to at least stay with him and make a bit of a game of it, but this afternoon's session, he was dynamite. I mean, his potting, they keep talking about his potting's phenomenal, but his safety's, I mean, different class. I was welded all the time with the cushion, and I had no chance really the night.
Graham, we've learned you're a great player too, and you'll come back and do it all again. I'm sure you'll believe in yourself.
Hopefully, I mean, I'll believe myself a bit more now.
Can I just suggest, keep the cue, it's going okay. Ronnie, before we get over to some presentations, just what are you going to achieve from now on? You've taken the game to such a different level. You enjoy entertaining the crowd too. The way you play, people say you're not a rocket, you're a magician. What are you going to do with your game now?
I'm not too sure, you know. I'm really not too sure, you know. I'm just going to enjoy the moment. And who knows next season, I don't know what I'm going to do, you know, I'm just going to enjoy it for the moment and take some time off in the summer. And if I do carry on playing, I just want to keep improving. So that's it, really.
You've really entertained us, and it's great to see your mum and all your family and your friends. You have a great support team around you, don't you?
Yeah, I didn't expect them to be here, you know, I wanted to just get on with the job, and I told people that I didn't want them here. Maybe it's a bit selfish, but you have to look after number one sometimes, and this is the greatest tournament any snooker player can play in, and it means so much to me. So, you know, and I just want to say for my dad, you know, this one's for him, you know, so for my man.
Not easy. Graham, congratulations. Ronnie, just take a moment, because there's a few things you've got to go through yet. Ladies and gentlemen, a great final, two great players that really entertained us. PBSA and Mr. Peter Dyke from World Promotions. Gentlemen, welcome. The runner-up will receive a cheque for £125,000. Graham Dott. The winner will receive a cheque for £250,000, the championship trophy, a magnum of champagne victor, and the title, 2004 Embassy World Snooker Champion, Ronnie O'Sullivan.
Ronnie just having a joke there with the false teeth. Little trick on Ray Reardon, I suspect. But a terrific moment there for Ronnie O'Sullivan. Stephen John with me in the studio here. What really has most impressed you about the way Ronnie has played the last 17 days? Cueing, concentration, what?
Focus, Hazel. Absolute focus from ball one right the way through, but particularly from the quarter final. I don't ever remember him being like that. There's been sessions of it, but I thought his focus has been brilliant all the way through.
Yeah, I think Ronnie's put on a snooker masterclass in the last 2 weeks and has set a benchmark, possibly a new high, that's going to be difficult for other players to live up to, and it's going to be tough in some ways for Ronnie to live up to it, but the only way forward is to try and push the barriers of the game further, and Ronnie O'Sullivan is certainly capable of doing that.
What was the missing ingredient that Ray Reardon has so successfully managed to find?
It's difficult to know, really, with them. I mean, obviously, Ray is a very much an old head, very experienced. I think probably Ray's been a little bit like a father figure, if you like. He's been here and he's been helping Ronnie with that. And he's certainly been focused since he's turned up. And he's loved every minute of it, Ray, being here. And it's certainly helped Ronnie.
Well, there he is, enjoying his moment. Second time he's won this trophy and the title. But let's assess what Graham Dott's contribution has been. He's surprised everyone. What has this done for his reputation in the game, Steve?
Well, I think everybody within the game knew how good a player Graham Dott was, and I think it remains to be seen whether Graham Dott can use this as a springboard to pushing himself further up the rankings and winning ranking tournaments. He's got to sort of follow it up with something else, but it gives him a great chance.
And after smashing his cue, clearly he's found the one that works for him, but it does show you that a lot of this game is psychological. Just that little difference has made all the difference in his case.
Yeah, it's probably been a little bit harsh just to say it's the cue, because obviously it's the man who's wielding it all the time, but I've been very, very impressed with him. He can be proud of himself. He's got a nice little check to go on with, and he can enjoy his summer because he put a very big effort into it this week, and he comes out with a lot of credit.
He definitely does, that's for sure. Well, we're hoping to hear a little bit more from Ronnie in just a few moments, but we've been cocooned here at the Crucible for the last 17 days. I think the indentations on the sofa are quite noticeable by now, chaps. But it's certainly been an eventful championship, a mixture of brilliant and bizarre moments.
What had happened is at the end of the match, I turned around and shook his hand and said,
"You're out of the top 16 next year," something along those lines. And yeah, I wasn't happy about that.
Hey, the man left the outside. I'm waiting for you out there.
It's almost as if I'm going to hit him on national TV, is it?
If Clinton wants to fight me for 50 grand, I'd be more than welcome to fight him for 50 grand. And you know, give me 8 weeks to get in shape, and I could do with that sort of money to last me through the summer.
I banged the table once, I made one gesture, I'm rude, I'm arrogant, that's what they've been saying, you know.
He's a magician and he just goes into a spell.
A long way. That looks as though it's going to be his last chance. Is it asking too much to be given
time to know his son? Peter Ebdon, ever the gentleman, congratulating Ian McCulloch. McCulloch goes through to round two.
Big moments in the snooker life of Barry Pinches here.
Nice if you could win a frame just sitting in your seat and while your opponent's at the table. Don't think that's ever been done before, Clive.
So here we go, take seven.
Fail and a miss. Anthony Hamilton, four.
Foul and a miss.
Joe, what have you done here? Well, I think in cricket that'd have been called a wide.
Foul.
So, the last blunder of many.
Well, Jimmy's not hit one shot the right side of the ball yet.
Would Ryan you Day. Believe it?
Took me eyes off it. And hit it far too hard. And I think that was the only ball in the entire match that I, you know, that I didn't look at when I was pot on it.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world
smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
When the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain,
bring on the
stop
rain.
Your sighing,
stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
keep on smiling,
keep on smiling,
and the world will smile.
Where's the green going?
Surely not.
Where's this red going? Where is it going? It's going in the pocket.
When you press me to your heart and tell me a world where roses bloom, and when you see angels sing from above, everyday void seems to turn into love song. Give your heart and soul to me, and life will always bloom.
What's going to happen here? Oh, goodness gracious me. That's extraordinary. Look at that. Hello. That's what you need, a little bit of form.
He's potted it. Unbelievable.
Yes, another great championship, and at the end of it, this trophy belongs to Ronnie O'Sullivan. Congratulations from all of us in here.
Cheers,
Ronnie.
Yep.
And we're also joined by Ray Reardon, the magician who's helped to improve the form of this gentleman. Now, Ronnie, this is the second time you've won the trophy. Does it mean more the second time than it did the first?
I suppose you know what it's all about when you've won it once, so the second time round, you just sort of trying to just sit back a little bit and just sort of like allow everything to come to you and just enjoy it, because it's a wonderful thing for me, you know, to have won it again. I'm very proud and very happy.
Well, there's been a lot of talk this fortnight about Ray's involvement in your camp. What exactly has he done? How has he helped you specifically?
Done nothing.
Yeah. You're too modest.
Well, I mean, I think the way Ray was explaining things to me, I think he would have won the World Championships, you know, today, because of the different sort of game that he's added to mine. You know, I don't really want to say what it is. We like maybe keep it private, but I'll tell you what, it's made me I'm starting to enjoy the game even more now, you know, and that's a beautiful thing, you know, because it's not just about potting balls. There's another side to the game.
That's one thing I noticed, apart from the fact you played an all-round brilliant game, was that actually, for the first time, you know, in our experience, you acknowledged the crowd a bit more and enjoyed the crowd, and they enjoyed you enjoying that.
Yeah, I think it's important, you know, that the fans come out to watch the snooker, and, you know, you can just sort of like walk off straight away, but I think it's nice to give them a little bit of a wave, because, you know, they pay good money, and, you know, and they bring the best out in you as well.
I think you've been very selfish, though. You realise his golf handicap's going to go up now. He hasn't practised all
week. Well, you know.
Ray, you've won six titles yourself, but how much satisfaction do you get from Ronnie's victory this time?
Oh, immense. Really immense. It was wonderful. In fact, I think I was more nervous than he was. I was more nervous watching than I was when I was playing. And he did it so well. He worked hard for it. He did a lot of practicing. I mean, there was one occasion, he'd had a late night and he hadn't gone, not going out anyway, he was just tired, and he couldn't go to sleep thinking of what was going to happen the next day. And he's telling me, he said, I couldn't get to sleep until 4 o'clock this morning. He said. And there we were, 11 o'clock practicing, and we had a good hour and a half practice. Then he went on and played. Then he went back to the hotel. He came back in and practiced again. He did a bit more. He went and played the evening session. He went for a four-mile run. And I said, when shall I see you? He said, what about 11 o'clock tonight? I thought, that's dedication. He's worked hard. He deserves the credit. He played brilliant. Outstanding.
And Ronnie, would you hope to continue your association with him?
As long as Ray's happy with it, you know, and we've grown so close as friends, you know. I didn't really know Ray until when he came down here, but he's a top man, and I just love being around him. And, you know, I'm very lucky, you know, for Ray to have said yes to come and help me, you know, because it's been an amazing experience.
He's the magician, you know.
Indeed.
He shouldn't be called Rocket, he should become a magician, the magician.
In which case, how many more titles does the magician have in him?
I'm not too sure, you know. I'd like to think I could win another couple. You know, I'd like to maybe get to, you know, win at least another one, but maybe four or five. I think you should set yourself some high targets just to keep the motivation going. And this is what it's all about, doing it at Sheffield. I know it's nice to be number one and to win other tournaments, but this is just the only tournament there is, really, you know. But, you know, I've had a good year, and all the other victories mean a lot as well. So, you know, just to do well here has really capped it off, you know.
But you've also said this week, Ronnie, that you'd like to try a season left-handed.
Yeah.
Are you serious about that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely serious about that, because I believe that I can really, really play some good stuff in my left hand, and I just think it's, you know, it'll make me an even better player to have that in my armoury. But when I use it, I want to be able to use it and not make a show of myself. I want to be able to, you know, take unders.
Yeah, I'm saying you're really bad with it now, aren't you?
No.
If you won't believe it, he said to me on one occasion, he said, I like using my left hand, he said, but I'm embarrassed for using it. He said, I think I may offend my opponent or something. And I said, well, look, you'll use it as long and as often as you can, because it's fantastic. You've God given you something here, and if you don't want it, give it to me.
Nice one, Rick. Well, thank you very much indeed for coming in, gents.
Thanks,
I believe this is yours. Congratulations
to you.
We've got an awful lot more to come from BBC Sports over the coming summer, and we're also looking forward to Sport Relief. The big night is on July the 10th, and the boys have been doing their bit for Sport Relief. Ray can explain to us.
Coming up this summer, on Saturday, July the 10th, is Sport Relief Saturday. I'm sure you're aware that 2 years ago, Sport Relief raised over £3 million. This time round, it's hoped we can do better than that, and in order to do that, everyone is being encouraged to go the extra mile, including this fine body of men.
Come on.
50% of the money raised goes to help disadvantaged children here at home. The other half goes to projects around the world. Sport can really help bring about change. You could contribute to Sport Relief is via an online auction. Some fantastic prizes available, a painting signed by former Embassy World Champions, also a 6x3 table signed by all the players taking part in this year's championship. For our Sport Relief competition, we asked you the name of the year that Dennis Taylor won the World Championship. The answer was 1985, and the lucky winner, Cora Hanley from Ealing. She gets tickets for next year's World Championship, as well as a signed Sport Relief T-shirt. Well done, Cora.
Yes, there's a spot for them on the British team for Athens yet. And if you'd like to get involved with Sport Relief, just hotfoot it to the website. It's bbc.co.uk/sportrelief. Well, that just about brings to an end our 17-day marathon on the sofas here. As usual, lads, thoroughly enjoyed it. What for you has been the highlight?
Well, obviously, Ronnie O'Sullivan winning the World Championship. It's been a great season of snooker, I think.
I think some fluid intake and some fresh air definitely called for, John. Thank you very much once again for your company for the last 17 days, guys. But tonight, Ronnie O'Sullivan has confirmed what we already knew. He is the best player in the world. From us all here at the Crucible Theatre, thanks for your company. Bye-bye for now.